A very good morning, Ambassador Gopinath Pillai, Chairman of ISIS and Ambassador at Large, Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Professor Subhadra, Director of ISIS, distinguished panelists, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Silvia, and today I have the honor and the pleasure of being your MC. Welcome to this afternoon's ISIS Symposium on India Budget 2017, Analyzing the Impact. It is my pleasure now to invite Ambassador Pillai to give the opening remarks. Ambassador, please.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to this session. I want to start off by thanking the panelists. I've had several calls from people to say that we have put together a very good team. But I said this, the credit goes to Dr. Amitendu, who has done it in consultation with the director, Professor Mitchell. So the credit must go to them. I'll keep my comment short because it has become a little not so welcoming for a businessman to talk. In the last 30 days, the stock of businessmen has dropped tremendously in the international scene. So I'm trying to propagate a theory that rationality, rational behavior, varies inversely with accumulation of wealth. In other words, as you accumulate your money, you become less rational. And there are examples to prove this, but I'm not sure whether that will be acceptable, except that I want to point out that the ancient Hindus had somewhat a poor opinion of businessmen, and therefore they put them in their caste hierarchy somewhere at the bottom. So it may be that they are wiser than we have been. We seem to have progressed and accepted irrational behavior. But anyway, that's not what we're talking about. Maybe that would be more interesting, but we are going to talk about Indian budget. There are two points I want to make on the budget. The first one was that I was pleased to see that this was not a political budget, it's not an election budget. And Jahangir pointed out to me that's not because of any virtue on the part of the government, the Indian government, but because of the fear of the Election Commission, which has in the last 30 years performed extremely well as an institution, a credible institution, to hinder any malpractices in the election. Could be or could not be, but anyway, the budget. The budget, as in the previous years, concentrates on a few areas. The rural economy, agriculture, infrastructure. And then there is a little bit on the black money, how to control it. So this is good. But what interested me most was the fact that the capital gains tax would be exempt. Amaravati city's construction, the land pooling, the profit from this will be exempted from capital gains tax. This is significant because I think this is allows the land pooling practice to be repeated in other parts of India. Getting land in India is a major exercise, and all sorts of terrible things happen during this. Mafia gets involved, and all sorts of people get involved. But with this, it becomes much more attractive. I was in Anantha recently, in Vizag, and the chief minister made an announcement that all the land that had been pooled, which is about 30,000 acres, 25% of that has been returned to the farmers. And now what has happened is that 25% has become more expensive. The value of that 25% has gone up more than the entire lot that they had surrendered. So they are very happy. The farmers are very happy. And if there is no capital gains tax on it, I think it adds to the attractiveness of the thing. and this could help to solve the land, the mess that land creates in India when you try to acquire land for industries and so on. So those are the two points I wanted to make, but I'm not here to talk about the budget. I'm here just to thank the panelists and thank you all for coming. Early in the morning is not the best of times to have a forum, but venue was not easily available, number one. And venue costs have gone up. Number two, ICES has a track record of having two things. One is having events like this in a timely fashion, not 2-3 months after the event, but fairly close to the event so that it is remains topical. The second is we come out with insights, briefs, and other sort of write-ups on events as they happen. Sometimes it has not matured there, but still we proceed to make our comments, and that leads to discussions, debates, and so on. And for this, we have gained some traction in Singapore, and we have been, sort of encouraged to do this by various institutions. So we'll continue to do this. The next event probably would be something that after the UP elections, we probably will have something. Hopefully that will also have an interesting sort of conclusion, how it will, whatever happens, it will have an impact on the national politics of India, because UP is the largest state with more than 200 members of parliament sitting for it. So there are exciting times ahead, but let's get on to this, and I welcome you again once again. Thank you very much. I hope you enjoy it.
Thank you, Ambassador Pillai. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like now to invite on stage our distinguished speakers for the panel discussion. Dr. Jahangir Aziz, Chief Asia Economist, JP Morgan. Mr. Rohan Solapurkar, Tax Partner, Deloitte Singapore. Dr. Venkatraman, Anantha Nageswaran, former Chief Investment Officer, Ben Julius Baer, an affiliated faculty, Singapore Management University. Dr. Vikram Khanna, Associate Editor, The Business Times, Singapore Press Holdings. And Dr. Amitendu Palit, Senior Research Fellow and Research Lead, Trade and Economic Policy, ICES. Dr. Palit will chair the panel discussion.
Thank you.
I shall now leave the floor to Dr. Pali. Thank you, Dr. Pali.
Thank you very much, Sylvia. And along with Ambassador Pillai and Mr. Sugata Mitra, I begin by thanking the panelists for taking their time off on a busy weekday to come and attend the Indian budget. I thank all of you for being here in the morning. In a sense, it shows the pull of the Indian budget, because I think for a couple of us, we know that we are right in the middle of a group of activities that is taking place in Singapore, discussing the Indian budget. This started from the last weekend. I think Rohan and I were together in one of the discussions, and we'll go on till the end of the week. Without wasting further time, I think I'll start off by bringing in front of you a couple of issues regarding the Indian budget. This Indian budget will probably be remembered many years later for a few structural changes that it introduced. Number one is that it's being presented on a date, which is at least a month ahead of when it is normally presented. The budget is usually presented on the last working day of the month of February. This time it is the 1st of February. So in that sense, it's been a departure, and the technical reason that's been given for the budget being brought forward is the fact that for for many of us who don't know the process, the budget is actually the presentation of the finance bill. And the finance bill is debated in the parliament for about 3 to 4 months, and by the time it's eventually passed, things move on from the current financial year to the next financial year. So in the meantime, for maintaining the government salaries and expenditure, it's necessary to take a vote on account. And the technical explanation has been that the government wanted to revise that vote on account and ensure by the end of the current financial year, the finance bill is passed, so much so that from the beginning of the next financial year, the finances can be issued in order. Number two is, after 92 years, there was no railway budget this time. And the railway budget has been merged with the general budget, and the investments for railways, the expenditure, have all been put under the general budget departmental outlay accounts. And the third point, a technical point more from an accounting perspective, is that for some of you might be familiar with the Indian budget documents, there used to be a distinction between planned and non-planned expenditure, which has been done away with. So in this budget, we are just left with the revenue and the capital accounting side. But those are in so far as the stylistic classification and functional changes with the budget are concerned. There is a lot more to this budget, as it usually is with most Indian budgets. Huge accounting exercise, lots of numbers, lots of schemes, lots of policies, so much so that it's difficult to analyze all of them in totality. But in order to do that, in order to accomplish that very difficult task, we have a most distinguished group of panelists over here with us. And I'll begin by asking Dr. Jahangir Aziz to give his views. We would be speaking for about 10 to 15 minutes, and then we have a discussion. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ambassador Pillai, Dr. Mitra, for inviting me once again. And thanks, Amitendu. Let me begin by setting the stage for this year's budget. What was expected on the day before the budget. So if you look at the week, 2 weeks prior to the budget, there was a lot of expectations that this budget could possibly veer away from the path of the straight and narrow and come up with quite dramatic changes in tax policies, dramatic changes in expenditure, etc. And the argument was that, look, there is demonetization that has happened in the economy, and that demonetization could have a large negative impact. Whether or not official data reflects that or not, that's a separate issue. But everyone's looking at auto sales, this, that, and the other, and things are not going very well. And then, as Ambassador Philip pointed out, there's these four state elections coming up, and this was the budget prior to the state elections. And so there was a lot of expectation that this budget could do things. Now, all of that wasn't supposed to be positive. For example, if you were in the equity market, the equity markets were concerned that the government would start taxing, imposing a long-term capital gains tax on equities. If you were in the bond market, you were concerned that when the government could actually have a very large fiscal deficit to support the economy, or fears that the economy could actually slow down. And then there were things like the government could start imposing a tax on actual banking transactions, etc., etc., etc. Our view was that whatever the government did, the government had to first establish a narrative about what's happening to India, or what they expect to happen in India in 2017-18, what is happening to the global economy, and unless that narrative, and they can't do anything inconsistent with that narrative. So if the narrative turns out to be that, well, demonetization is just going to have a transient or a temporary effect on the economy, maybe consumption is going to fall because of the liquidity shock coming from the fact that cash has still not come back in the economy, that's just a couple of quarters shock. But if you have a couple of quarters shock, what's the point of doing anything on the fiscal side? Because by the time you make a fiscal policy change, let's say February 1st, by the time it's implemented, which is probably going to be July or August, all of that shock is gone away. Fiscal policy is a terrible instrument to respond to short-term shocks. Fiscal policy is a great instrument to respond to medium-term shocks because it takes time and it's very difficult to reverse once you implement either a program or a tax policy change. So the view had to be not just about 2017-18, but a view about what's going to happen to India over the medium term. And if the view is that, well, demonetization hasn't doesn't really have more than 2-3 quarter effect, then you know you're not going to get very much in terms of a change in the narrative from the government. And if you don't get a change in the narrative from the government about how they see the world in the next 2-3 years, then why should they change fiscal policy? The event that you can get dramatic changes in fiscal policy only if you change the narrative of what is happening today and what's happening in 2 to 3 years' time. What is your vision of the economy? And therefore, everything hinged on. So our view hinged on that. That if there is not much of a change, you know, you're going to get very little in terms of big policy changes or, you know, the fiscal deficit being blown out or being contracted very, very sharply, any of that stuff. So what did the narrative, what was the narrative of the Indian government in the budget speech? Well, the narrative was basically that demonetization may have a transient negative effect, but most likely it's going to have good effects over the medium term, nothing very specific, either in the budget or in the economic survey that came out the day before. So growth would be somewhere around 6.75, 7.5, inflation around 4 and 5, so nominal growth would be around 11-12%. Current account isn't going to blow up, it's going to remain contained. And so if all of those things are going to happen, then you know it is consistent with that view, you cannot have a budget that is dramatically different from what the government had promised to deliver. Now, if you go back to what the government had promised to deliver was a fiscal deficit of 3% this year from 3.5% last year. We were splitting the difference between 3.5 and 3, and we said it's going to be somewhere around 3 and 3.5, which is 3.3%. The government came up with 3.2%. There's a different context in which the 3.2% needs to be addressed, but I'm going to skip that for the time being. This has to do with the Fiscal Responsibility Act that the government that has been recommended by a panel of experts, and the government has to react to that, and we haven't seen a formal reaction to that as yet, but I'm going to skip that part. So if you're going to keep fiscal deficit around 3.2% from, you know, instead of meeting 3% fiscal deficit target for fiscal year 17-18, which was your original target 2 years back, a year ago, that was a promise. You know, you're hitting 3.2, you know, we can quibble about it, but 0.2% of GDP is not here. So if that's the narrative, that's your fiscal deficit part, then essentially what you're going to get in the belly of the if you go into the details of the budget is that you're going to get small changes. Now, Ambassador Pillai will say that the pooling tax benefit on pooling of land isn't a small change, and I will concede that there could be things that can have very large effect. But in by and large, you're not really going to change fiscal policy, tax policy dramatically. You're not going to change spending dramatically. You're going to keep within the narrow confines of what you did last year, and that's essentially what the government did. So, in terms of what are the big tax policy change, well, there wasn't very many. Corporate tax was brought down from 30 to 25%, not for everyone, only for those people who were, only for those companies that have a turnover below 500 million, which isn't very much in this day and age. Household income tax or personal income tax was brought down from 10% to 5% for those people earning from 5 million to 10 million in Indian rupees. Again, you know, affects a lot of people. It gives them a little bit of cushion, but it isn't a very big deal. Did they do anything dramatic on the expenditure front? Not really. If you look at the total amount of capital expenditure last year or the year ending 2017, total capital expenditure was about 1.3% of GDP. They kept to that. So it's again 1.3% of GDP. Now, in terms of what happened last year, the capital expenditure actually improved from the targeted 1.1% of GDP to 1.3% of GDP, and the government should be commended for increasing capital spending over there. But for 2017-18, nothing much was happening. If you look at the revenue assumptions look pretty much standard. There's nothing really shocking either about the expectation or the projections for tax revenues. If you look at the only place where you can really quibble about is where, for the last 3 years, this government has been promising privatization, which in India is called divestment, privatizing its public sector assets. Every year, it has missed that target by a significant amount. And this year again, it's promising a very large privatization. Most likely, it's going to miss it. Should we be worried about that miss? Probably yes, but when I was working in the government, I was told that if on the week before the end of the year, if your finance secretary can't come up with quarter percent of additional revenue from somewhere, he's not a very good finance secretary. So they can figure out ways of doing that. Maybe they'll get Reserve Bank of India to put a little bit more next year's transfers from their profits. So if you look at it from a macro point of view, which is what I do, there was a narrative, and the budget was consistent with the narrative. The narrative was that there isn't much that's going to happen in India in 2017-18, either a dramatic improvement of growth or a dramatic collapse. Inflation is going to be contained in that 4-5%. Current account is going to be in that 1-1.5% of GDP, and therefore the fiscal deficit was not 3% as promised, but 3.2% as promised. Now, and before I go into where my concerns are, let me give you a little bit of an aside. So there is this view that the central government has been pushing, and most analysts have been pushing, that this government has been consolidating the budget, i.e. cutting down the deficit ever since they came in, and that they started with somewhere around 4% of GDP when they took over office. Now they've brought it down to 3.5%, and they are targeted to go down to 3.2%. That is true as far as the central government is concerned. In these 3 years, if you look at what the state governments have done, they've actually done exactly the opposite. Every state government has blown their budget deficit targets. And if you combine the state and central government budget deficit, it has actually not moved. It's around 7% of GDP. It's been around 7% of GDP when they took office, and it's been 7% of GDP throughout the last 3 years, and most likely this year too, they are going to reach around that 7% of GDP. So there is this other question that, is this really fiscal consolidation? Yes, it is from the central government's point of view. As far as overall government is concerned, there hasn't really been any fiscal consolidation if you add the central and state governments together for the last 3 years. India's average growth rate has been around 7-7.5% over these 3 years, and you start wondering if at 7-7.5% real growth rate, you can't even consolidate even a little bit. When are you going to consolidate? But that's a separate issue. Okay? So let me tell you where my concerns are. When I look at this narrative that demonetization is going to be transient and growth is going to be around about 6.75-7.5%, which is what the economic survey has. Inflation is going to be contained, current account is going to be contained. I have a problem because that's not the word that any one of us, and Ambassador Pillai hinted to, for the last 1 month we've been talking about. We've been talking about a global economy, I'm not even talking about demonetization, a global economy that is facing serious risk of dramatic changes that's going to happen if the policy promises of the new US administration is followed through. What we have seen in the last 2 weeks of this administration taking over is that they actually are delivering on what they promised. So if you look at the 100-day promise of this incoming US administration, they are essentially ticking off one box after the other box. And one of the biggest things that is large, dramatic tax reforms in the United States of America. In particular, even though that's not in the 100-day promise, but that's the way it seems like it's going to go, something which is very innocuously called border adjustment tax. A border adjustment tax in the US is basically the following. I'm simplifying it, so if anyone, Alan, please jump in if I'm oversimplifying the things. But basically, this is what it is. That if you are a US company and you're importing any input, whether you're Walmart or whether you're Apple, any input that you're importing, you cannot call it a cost anymore. So you cannot deduct it as cost. However, whatever you're exporting, you don't have to include in your revenue. So essentially, all imports almost automatically will get taxed at the corporate tax rate, which they're planning to bring down from 35% to 20%. And all exports immediately become tax-free, essentially. So what does it do? Why are we so concerned? That the moment that is done, regardless of which country you are, doesn't really matter, post-tax US dollar rate depreciates by 25%, instantaneously. Why? Because you just made imports more costlier by 20%, you made exports cheaper by 20%, one divided by the other gives you 25%. Instantaneously, the US dollar depreciates against every currency under the sun by 25%. That is a massive depreciation. And it, of course, depends on how people react, how corporates react to that, how governments react to that, how central banks react to that. One benign reaction, so to speak, benign, is that all of us, Singapore, India, China, everybody, immediately depreciates against the US dollar by 25% for completely offsetting whatever advantage that the US has got. The problem is that we really can't depreciate by 25%. If we did that, it would be 1997, 98 all over again, the Asian crisis. So if you can't depreciate that much because we have issues in the US, I mean in our own countries, and if you depreciate, let's say, even halfway through, then you have a US economy that gets a significant competitive edge on a permanent basis. And that can change the entire global supply chain, that can change how emerging markets exports, what happens to emerging market imports, what happens therefore to growth, on an almost permanent basis. The problem is that in an entire budget speech, even though this was February, there was almost a afterthought mention of trade protectionism. So my concern is that, look, the budget is going to work as long as that narrative, that very benign narrative, works. If for any reason that benign narrative gets pushed back, and I'm not even going to demonetization, just on the global changes, then somewhere down halfway down the year, India, along with every emerging market, will have to reconsider their policy options in a significantly, in a very different environment. And if that happens, then we run into a problem where we aren't very sure, we meaning the outsiders, people who are not in the government, we aren't very sure what exactly is the government's response function. If there is a BAT, let's say by June this year, that is imposed by the, or adopted by the US, I haven't any idea how the Indian government is going to react. So I'm going to stop here and hand it over to you.
Thank you, Jahangir. So, Vikram, you will mind going in the next?
Okay, yeah. Thank you, and good morning, everybody. I was hoping that Jahangir would say everything there is to say, so that I don't have to say very much. And I think he succeeded in large measure. But let me just try some areas, some different areas, including new areas of concern. I mean, he mentioned a big one in the form of the PAT. But before that, let me just try and run through the sort of, as I see, the merits and demerits of the budget in quite summary form. I think on the merit side, I mean, I think the macroeconomic position is looking reasonably good. I mean, you have a good deficit of 3.2%, which is slightly lower, but it's not bad. Your current account deficit of 0.3%, which is decent. The growth is quite decent. The debt profile is coming down to 60% of GDP. And while India, I don't know if it has a strong case for a credit rating upgrade, India complains that its credit rating should not be so much lower than China's. China's is super investment grade, we are close to junk. I think the problem really is China's credit rating is too high. It's not that ours is too low. Because we still have, as Jahangir mentioned, fiscal deficits taken on an overall basis, including state governments and so on. This budget has been quite conservative on the expenditure side on the whole. I mean, the expenditure was, the growth was less than half of revenue growth. I mean, this might be because of the uncertainty about the GST and how that will work out. If it works out well, perhaps we can boost spending by more. But nevertheless, the spending has been pretty carefully targeted. It's biased towards rural India, as we would have expected, because rural India was the worst hit by the demonetization. So that expenditure is up 24%. There's huge allocation, record allocation for MGNREGA. This is the sort of job scheme, the rural employment guarantee scheme started by the Congress government. And there's also a promise for full rural electrification by May 2018, which will be wonderful. On the tax side, as Jahangir mentioned, is good for the middle class. 5% tax on incomes up to 5 lakhs, 2.5 to 5 lakhs. And thank goodness, a one-page form, which is really, really quite voluminous and in India, most welcome. There's no relief for the rich to speak of. The 15% surcharge on incomes above a crore remains. I have no problem with that. On corporate tax, as Jahangir mentioned, there's a good break for SMEs, and this is the majority of Indian companies. Small companies account for about 85% of manufacturing jobs. But then the downside is that there's nothing in it for big companies, and when you start discriminating on tax grounds in this way, you tend to incentivize companies to remain small. And this is a big problem for India. I think India needs more big companies. We need to be part of international supply chains, and you can't do it when 90% of your companies employ just 70 workers. So we need incentives for big companies as well. By the way, China, only about big companies employ the vast majority of workers. Small companies employ about 25% of workers. The fact that there's not much for big companies is not very good for job creation. And I would submit that job creation is really one of our biggest problems. I was shocked to see the statistic that whereas we have 12 million, 1 million people a month coming into the labor force, that's 12 million a year, the number of jobs, net jobs created in 2015 was just 135,000. 1,35,000. That is really a problem. There is another big obstacle to job creation, which I'll come to in a minute, and that is my biggest concern about this budget. On the demonetization, the exercise so far has basically tackled the stock of existing black money. I think the important thing is to address the flow, I mean the generation of new black money. They've taken some steps, they've put limits on cash transactions, about 3 lakhs, although 3 lakhs per person per day, that means you can split it up into many days if you like. There's also limit on cash donations, 2,000 per person, but no limit on the number of people to cash donations to political parties. There are some measures to encourage more digitization. There's zero duties on the point of sale devices, fingerprint readers and other devices of that kind. There's cashback schemes for sort of merchants using the government-supported Aadhaar-based payment system, and there's special bonus for consumers who use it as well. This will help to formalize transactions that were unrecorded before. And so thereby would erode some of the black money and widen the tax base. So this would help to flow to reduce the flow of black money, and the tax to GDP ratio could, if this all works out, be permanently higher. Could we do better? Probably. We could have. Well, we need to have nationwide broadband connectivity, make it a much bigger priority than it is. We need to raise the allocation for this dramatically, although the commitment to rural electrification will help. Second, we could hold off raising duties on PCBs, that's printed circuit boards or mobile phones. PCBs, this has been done in the name of import substitution. India wants companies to, we want to manufacture our own mobile devices rather than importing them from China. I think that's fine, I'm all for it. But the thing is, at this moment, I think the priority should be to increase adoption. Give nearly 100 million people more who are mobile connected. And I think we could have held off raising duties on PCBs until that happens, maybe a year or two. We also need to impose taxes on transactions that generate black money property. I think there probably will be a GST on property, maybe 18%, I'm not sure. So a lot of this will come with the tax net. And finally, I must say that the demonetization exercise has had a sort of signaling effect. I mean, you know, people will frown on black money transactions in a way that it did not before. I mean, before we sort of tacitly accepted that this is part of life. I don't think this will happen any longer. I think the whole exercise will hopefully influence behavior. And finally, I think, you know, to take a leaf out of Singapore's book, and this will be probably quite unpopular, but I think we need to raise civil service salaries, including agencies like the customs, the police, and the judiciary. I think one of my friends, Michael Backman, wrote this book on the Asian crisis, where he said that, look, in the context of Indonesia, if you have a judge who's paid $1,000 to $2,000 a month presiding over a multi-billion dollar lawsuit between two companies, what you end up with is not a lawsuit, but an auction. I don't know if you can say the same thing about India. I wouldn't be surprised if you can. Okay, my biggest concern, to take about my biggest concern, we were talking about job creation, and I think a big part of that story is the state of the banking system. I mean, our banks are basically on crutches. We desperately need a bank rehabilitation program. And the problem has been festering for 8 years, ever since the global crisis. The NPA, the non-performing assets of the overall banking system is around 9%. 9% was in September 2016. It probably is even worse now. That figure, by the way, was double what it was a year earlier. The state of nationalized banks is particularly bad. You have 13 banks who control about 40% of lending who have NPAs of 20%. This is a terrible situation. The government has been trying to, well, the proposed remedy is recapitalization. They've put up 70,000 crores over 5 years, 700 million. But Standard & Poor's, that's about $11 billion. Standard & Poor's suggests it should be $45 billion. But that's not really the problem. I don't think recapitalization has helped. It has basically enabled banks to just kick the can down the road. What they really need to do is have major debt reduction, and we need to take the loans off the books of the banks. That is not happening. Now, how do you do this? They have tried workouts. They have tried various things. They find it very difficult to do debt equity swap, because once you do a debt equity swap in India, you attract scrutiny from the Vigilance Commission, Right to Information Act. People can ask you, why did you do it for this guy? Why not for that guy? Why did you give so much away, etc. So I think we really need to have a sort of a quantum, a complete change in our approach to dealing with the banks. I think there's a terrific chapter in the Economist survey on this, in chapter 4, where they talk about setting up an asset management company. They call it the Public Asset Management, Public Asset Rehabilitation Agency, PARA. This will basically take, a central agency will take the loans, bad loans, off the books of the banks and then work them out either by auctioning them or by securitizing them or whatever. And I think we need something like this. And I think we need to take a lesson here from the Asian crisis, particularly from Korea and Malaysia, who did it. I mean, they got many things wrong during the Asian crisis, but this is one thing they got right. The Korean asset management company basically just went and bought out a lot of the NPAs from Korean banks, and they securitized them. They became a market maker. You know, they got buyers and sellers together. They got international parties interested in buying out some of the debt. I think the Malaysian example actually was particularly interesting. They had this agency called Dhanaharta, which basically went in. They didn't close any banks. They didn't have mass layoffs. They didn't take over any banks. They went in, bought the loans, made an offer price, and they were able to sort of sell them off quite quickly. They also were aided by something called the Dhanaharta Act, which is a very strong act of the legal provision, which enabled them to basically, they can foreclose on a company without going to court. They could take over the management of a debtor. They were given actually sweeping powers. I think within 3 years or so, about 60% of the debt was cleared out, and then they made recoveries, they put that back into banks. At the same time, they recapitalized subsequently, rather than trying to recapitalize first and then doing this workout later. So I think these are some of the lessons that we need to learn. This is especially relevant to job creation, because look, I mean, we've had, the lending to households has been quite strong, but most of that has come from private banks. Lending to agriculture has been okay. The lending to the corporate sector has been terrible. It's the lowest in 23 years. It's been negative in the last year, net lending. And unless your corporate sector can have access to credit, you're not going to create mass jobs. Infrastructure financing is another problem in the West that doesn't help the job creation. We do not have adequate infrastructure financing institutions. We basically have the Power Finance Corporation, the Rural Electrification Corporation, but IDFC has become a bank, IFCI is too small. So the heavy lifting for whole infrastructure financing has to be done by the banks, and they're not in a position, they're not the right entities to be doing 30-year financing. And we also have all kinds of restrictions that prohibit pension funds and provident funds from investing in these long-term projects. Pension funds cannot invest below AA, and it's very difficult to get a new project to have a AA rating, and so on. And the public sector banks, they also have other constraints. They have less freedom to do workouts than private sector banks. They have salary issues, they have governance issues. I think they're doing the best they can in circumstances, but really the circumstances are not conducive to good increases in capital lending, healthy lending, and healthy infrastructure lending, which is really what we need for job. So I'll stop there. Thanks.
Thanks, Vikram. So, Rohan, now on to you, because taxes are the most exciting, most disturbing part of this budget.
Thanks, Dr. Palit. After listening to such two eminent speakers talk about the economic policies and the way it is from an economic perspective, I think that seems to be fading away and being left as a laggard behind. For so many years, tax, the Indian budget used to have tax changes going pages and pages and pages. I think over the last couple of years, especially this year, we've seen tax changes not so significant. As Dr. Jahangir said, tax policy this year has been relatively simple, straightforward. Let's not try and tinker too much with the tax, and let's keep it straightforward. And that's consistent with the message that the government wanted to pass over a couple of years, that India is an easy place to do business. There is certainty in taxation, no retrospective taxation anymore. So I think those are the guiding sort of principles on which tax policy is being built by this government. And if one has to keep that as a basis on which tax policy or tax changes are going ahead, I think this government has done a fairly decent job on that. I won't get into the mechanics and the advantages or drawbacks of keeping that, but this, I'll just talk a very high level on what some of the significant tax changes have happened in this budget. Of course, corporate tax rates have come down, as both the earlier speakers said, but for a select class of companies. But what has not happened is the surcharges are not changed. These surcharges are important for a specific purpose. There's a surcharge and there's an education cess, and both of these continue to apply. So although your corporate tax rate has gone down from 30 to 25%, it still goes up as an effective tax rate to approximately 30% if you add in the surcharges. That's one. Secondly, if one looks at dividend distribution tax, again, there's no change in the dividend distribution tax. So if one has to add that back in, it takes it up even more. So those are some changes one would have liked to see. Of course, India also has a minimum alternate tax, and there's no change in the minimum alternate tax rates also. So although there's a change in the corporate tax rate for certain select class of companies, there's no change in the minimum alternate tax rate. So that's a little bit of a dampener there. In respect of startups, where there were certain incentives that were given to startups last year, keeping in mind the theme of Made in India, Startup India, Digital India. The finance minister had introduced certain incentives given to startups, which said that 100% of the profits were going to be exempt if you were a sort of an eligible company in the business of innovation, creation, technology, things like that. He's made a little bit of change there in the context of the profits were exempt for a period of 3 years within a 5-year window. He's now extended the 5-year window to make a 7-year window. Small change, but nonetheless could impact innovative companies who are eligible for this. Keeping in line with that change, he's also recognized that startups require more funding, and therefore at any given point of time there's a change in shareholders that might happen. Now, like in Singapore, there is also a law in India, a section or provision in the Income Tax Act in India that says that you can carry forward your losses only if your shareholders remain the same on the date the loss was incurred and the date you want to carry forward the loss. But for startups, he's sort of made a concession, and he says that even though you continue to get new shareholders in, as long as the promoters continue to hold shares on the date the loss was incurred and the date the loss is being carried forward, they will be eligible for this incentive or benefit of carry forward losses. Again, small change, but I think a significant change for startups that are there. A little bit of changes on infrastructure funding. There was a particular section which, from a withholding tax perspective, attracted a 5% withholding tax if companies borrow in India from overseas lenders. So in the context of infrastructure funding or infrastructure lending, if you were borrowing from international agencies for infrastructure purposes, there was a 5% withholding tax. That 5% withholding tax was due to expire on 30th June 2017. He's now extended that up to 30th June 2020. In addition, what he's also done is given a similar exemption for rupee-denominated bonds, which are also called masala bonds. So he sort of extended financing for which you can borrow for infrastructure purposes with a 5% withholding tax. What he's done this time is made a little bit of an adjustment in the context of a deduction on interest from related parties. So let me just elaborate a little bit of that. Until now, there was no restriction on the quantum of deduction that you can claim for interest, which you pay out, provided you have the withholding tax obligations being met. He's now introduced a restriction on interest paid by an Indian company to its related party. And that restriction is about 30% of EBITDA. So any Indian company which is borrowing from its overseas parent, any form of debt, whether even through a corporate guarantee, any form of debt, and if interest gets paid out under that, that interest will now be restricted for a deduction for income tax purposes, and that interest deduction will be equal to 30% of EBITDA. So in a way, what he's introduced is thin capitalization norms, although thin capitalization norms are not prescribed under corporate law. In a sense, he's now introduced a debt-equity ratio or thin capitalization norms for tax purposes. So there's a restriction that happens there. And that's important to note because this is for, there's no sort of grandfathering on loans in this. So any loans which you've given in the past also, which attract interest or which pay, which companies are paying out now, and the amount of interest is 1 crore. 1 crore is about $200,000, which is not really as significant. So companies which are in the real estate sector, which largely do funding through convertible debentures or debt, will get significantly impacted by this provision. As one of my earlier speakers also alluded to the fact that, you know, there was a little bit of noise pre-budget whether there would be taxes on capital gains and on sale of units, bonds, etc. Actually, he's come back and clarified. He's made certain clarifications on capital gains tax. Importantly, in that context, he's come back and said there will be no indirect taxes on transfer of units made by unit holders on Category 1 and Category 2 FPIs. Let me just give you a sort of a explanation to this. So what happens is India has foreign portfolio investors. So you have funds which are set up overseas, which registered in India as foreign portfolio investors. You have non-resident unit holders who make investments into these foreign portfolio investments, which are registered outside, and they invest. Now, what is famously known as and quote unquote the Vodafone case, which says that if there are any indirect transfers being made outside of India, and if there is those indirect transfers are specifically in relation to Indian assets or substantial Indian assets, then those transfers get taxed. In December, the Indian government introduced a circular which said that indirect transfers being made outside India by unit holders of these foreign portfolio investments would be subject to tax in India. There was a representation that went out from the industry saying that this would create chaos, it would have an impact on the market, and therefore the government should withdraw this. The government heeded the representation and has now come back and clarified that there will be no transfer taxes or indirect transfer taxes on transfer of these units across. Other important changes that he's introduced, he's confirmed that the anti-avoidance rules will now trick off. That means from April 1, 2017, any transaction which lacks substance or commercial substance and is primarily done with the objective of tax avoidance or tax evasion will be subject to anti-avoidance rules in India, which means that the tax authorities in India now have the right to disregard that transaction, which means they can treat debt as equity, they can treat equity as debt, they can look through a particular transaction, they can lift the corporate veil. So fairly wide sweeping powers given to tax authorities. Of course, they've come back and clarified to say that, you know, we are not going to get into a fishing expedition, only genuine anti-avoidance schemes are going to be looked at, but, you know, the reputation of the Indian tax authorities precedes them. So one has to take that with a little bit of a pinch of salt, and let's hope that, you know, they live up to their word. The other significant amendment that's come in is something which is known as place of effective management. And this is largely important for Indian subsidiaries which are outside. Now, Indian corporates get taxed on global income if they become tax residents of India. Now, tax residency in India is defined in the context of where your effective management is based. They've come back and said that for a foreign company, so to elaborate for an example, let's say you have an Indian holding company which sets up a Singapore subsidiary. But if all the control and management of that Singapore company still resides in India, which means you have your board of directors meetings there, or decisions are being done by shareholders, which actually should not happen by shareholders, but should be within the Singapore company, or if there are any sort of turnover criteria which are not being met by the Singapore company, in those circumstances, the Singapore company will be treated as having its place of effective management in India. And as a consequence of that, it would mean that the profits which are earned by the Singapore company would be subject to tax in India. So it's a far-reaching implication that could be for Singapore companies or any company which is outside of India, but still has effective decision-making and control based in India. And this is very important for Indian promoter-led companies. So that's something one should consider. GST is stopped short of saying that GST will be introduced on July 1, but from all sources, all sort of anecdotal discussions, it seems to be that GST will be introduced on July 1. There are certain service tax changes that he's made, and those service tax changes are effective only up till 30th June 2017. So if one has to read between the lines, the only implication or the implicit meaning that comes out is that GST will be introduced from 1st of July, which hopefully would be a large sort of game changer in the Indian context for a tax perspective. I think it's the largest sort of tax reform that India would have seen ever since independence. Keeping in theme with demonetization and getting out of black money, he has come back and said that any transaction in excess of 300,000 rupees, if done in cash, will not be permitted. And anyone who receives that money in excess of 300,000 rupees, that person, the recipient, will be subject to a penalty. And that penalty would be equal to the amount of money that he received. So that in that context, you know, he's keeping in theme with demonetization and trying to root out black money, corruption. Of course, there will always be cynics which will come back and say, but how is he going to know? How are you going to catch it? How are you going to find out? Yes, those are fair and valid questions, but at least the intent seems to be very clear from the government. And the message that is being passed on is, we're very certain that we want to root out and throw out black money from the system. So I think those are the broad sort of changes that have happened. Yes, they've made some changes on personal taxes, minor changes on the rates, but you know, he could have done a little bit more on that aspect. With that, I'll hand it back.
Thank you, Rohan. Anantha, you have some slides to show us. So those are coming up. Maybe what we'll do is, while Anantha shows his slides, we'll just go down and take our seats so that we get an uninterrupted.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and I'll wait for my colleagues to take their seats before I begin. It's often said that, you know, coming last is a little bit of a disadvantage because most of the points that you want to say might have been said by others. But that is not the issue today here, because this country is so huge and so heterogeneous, and the budget documents have so many layers and layers within, as PT would also put it, wheels within wheels, that it is difficult for any one person to do justice to all the documents and all the points made. So there is still something left for somebody else to say. For example, when I just came in this morning, Ambassador Pillai in his opening remarks pointed out the implications of what has been done for the land pooling and the exemption from capital gains tax for the Amaravati capital of Andhra Pradesh. So that is something which some of us have not paid attention, at least not high. And we had Jahangir talking about the fact that the budget is consistent with a particular narrative, and so to that extent it has stuck to a sort of a path of prudence and caution in the near term. But he also made the point that a fiscal policy in general is a medium term instrument. And that is where, in some sense, my remarks would be directed at. is it addressing the medium-term concerns of the Indian economy? And of course, we had Vikram talk quite a bit in detail about job creation and also about the fact that concessions were extended to small and medium companies but not large companies, and the implications of that for job creation between small and medium versus large enterprises. And he also made the interesting point that it is not that the Indian credit rating is low, but Chinese credit rating could be quite high. That's anyway something which the Indian chief economic advisor had something to say in his economic survey and also in opinion articles following that. And it was wonderful to hear Rohan go into some of the most important issues on anti-avoidance and place of effective business, etc. So there is plenty of differentiated coverage. And I think if I want to give you a context to my remarks, it would be based on the fact that are these budget measures or the budget document itself, is it addressing the medium-term challenges that the Indian economy faces? So in that sense, it fits a particular narrative. So it is safe and sound. It is not doing anything rash. But is that enough is my question. And sort of, if you look at the context before the budget, not just the previous 2 weeks or previous 2 days, but the previous 6 months, we have had a change of guard. The Reserve Bank has now become a distant memory already. But it is a fact that, therefore, there are some still lingering questions about the relationship between the Reserve Bank of India and the government, and the demonetization exercise also brought some of those issues to the fore. And then we have, which I think Vikram mentioned quite clearly, therefore that saves me some time, the banking system non-performing asset issue for various reasons, political and economic, are being addressed or not being addressed and is being left to sort itself out, mostly by default. And yes, the government in the official document takes the GST implementation as something that will happen outside, because the government still has estimates for service tax, excise duty, etc. But importantly, the union government has agreed to compensate the states for revenue shortfall. And some of the cess, the additional levies that the government imposed on luxury items in the GST, supposed to help them compensate the states if there's revenue shortfall. If you're a prudent accountant, you would like to provide for the contingency that the government may have to compensate the states. But because the budget takes the view that GST is outside its framework, the budget does not provide for compensating for GST shortfall. You can argue that it's not a serious omission, but from the point of view of prudence, perhaps it is an omission that the government doesn't provide for a contingent liability it may have to incur if there is a GST shortfall on the state's share of the general and the goods and services tax. And this point and this point are part of the same. And at the moment, the economic growth in the country is being led primarily by private consumption, which again Vikram alluded to, because private banking loans are going for consumption items, industrial loans are happening, and mostly by government spending. So, in some sense, these issues are being there. To what extent does the budget cover these issues? Now, you look at this chart here, it has to be a little bit carefully looked at because you have two scales here. What is happening, this is from the data provided by the Department of Industrial Policy and Promotion. The blue bars represent the investment proposals submitted to DIPP for information or for approval. It is called Investment Enterprise Momentum. That's on your left scale, rupees billion, okay? On the right scale, which is the line, is actually the investment proposals implemented. Now, the line may look much higher than the bar, but please remember, the bars pertain to the left scale and the line pertains to the right scale. So until about 2011 or 12, the investment proposals implemented versus submitted were just a very small percentage, almost negligible percentage of the proposals submitted. Suddenly after 2011, whether it is due to some reporting changes or accounting changes, it has jumped up. But still, it is only about 20% of the proposals submitted that are getting implemented. So even with this sudden jump in the proposals being implemented, it constitutes 1/4 or 1/5 of the investment proposals that are being considered. So we have a problem with capital formation. to some extent, this is corroborated by the Reserve Bank of India data, where they go from the bottom-up information that they receive through various ways of mobilizing finances for new investments. You look at the downward trend, capital expenditure by the private corporate sector. This is covered in the September issue of the Reserve Bank of India monthly bulletin. You can see here, there is a very steady decline in the capital expenditure by the private sector. So if you're talking about the medium term and the potential growth of the country, what does the fiscal policy do towards improving these two aspects? I didn't think I found too many answers in this particular budget document. And then very interestingly, two professors of the United States have come up with an economic policy uncertainty index. The algorithm looks for particular key expressions in media and try to compute the extent of policy uncertainty. You can download that from the internet. They give you all their methods and their data. For interestingly, the economic policy uncertainty index as of December 2016 is higher than what it was when this government took office in May 2014. So there is an issue here. If you go by the veracity or the reliability of this particular calculation, clearly uncertainty hasn't reduced, but either remains the same or even slightly higher than it was when this government took office about 30 months ago. So these issues are untouched. On my own, I had made a few checklists when I wanted to evaluate the budget because I have a weekly column going on a newspaper in India. I had made these various checklists, how I'm going to look at the budget and evaluate it, whether it confirms or satisfies some of these issues. I think the assumptions are largely okay. If I go back here, assumptions are largely okay. I think Jahangir touched upon that, whether the revenue growth or the GDP growth, they're all right. And this is where I have major issues. I think it is one thing to go after evaders and offenders and the low tax to GDP ratio, etc., all that is fine. But the bulk of the problem of tax compliance in the country is also due to not just the rates, but also the administration. I mean, Rohan said, you know, the government promises not to go on a fishing expedition, but we know that when they are given revenue targets and the incentives are aligned with revenue targets, and obviously fishing expeditions become inevitable. And also, Indian tax rate may be the 30%, the top tax rate for income tax, for personal income tax, but it kicks in at a very low level. It probably hasn't adjusted for the fact that inflation between 2009 and 2014 cumulatively was more than 60%, the CPI inflation rate, official inflation rate. Unofficial it could be higher depending on each one's budget or each one's basket of consumption. And also the World Bank, ease of doing business, has a tax incidence ratio which not just looks at the income tax but looks at various taxes that a company pays out of its profits. And that number is 60.6% for India. Out of some 190 odd countries in the world, only about 10 of them have this ratio at 60% or above, and India is one of them. So in that sense, I think whatever this government has been doing in the last 3 years is adversarial in nature, and part of it is required, by the way. I don't deny that. But what does it do for the aspirational segment of the Indian population? You have a huge demographic bulge, which needs to, you know, feel part of the economic activity, which should be facilitated. Is that happening? The government has been somewhat pusillanimous with its approach. Last year, they promised that they would bring down the corporate tax rates over the next several years, eliminate exemptions and make it simple. There is no follow through in this budget. And last year, they made a very good beginning in reducing the payroll tax burden on businesses, saying the government would bear part of the PF contributions, etc. Again, that has remained somewhat still born in this budget. There's no follow-through on some of these things. I think that is what is required to make businesses feel that it is worthwhile to become formal and come under the radar of the government. Otherwise, the cost of staying informal might have gone up, but the benefits of going formal haven't commensurately gone up. So in that sense, are you really addressing the issue of informality and formality with only one partial demonetization move? That's the question here. I think I'll skip this because Rohan has addressed some of them. And this was something introduced last year which gave the tax authorities permission to go back and reopen tax assessments all the way back to the old Stone Age. But that has been now taken out in this budget, which is good. And of course, we have seen that. I think it's more of a narrative which this government has created between rich and poor, but I think it is not necessarily the most healthy way of addressing the issue of, you know, black money. You don't need to create a class war on top of everything else that is going on in the country. And this is something which I mentioned earlier, capital formation is lacking. The budget doesn't provide enough incentives. This is touched upon already. And this to me is the biggest disappointment. 1997 was the last time when some finance minister wanted to make a bold departure from the tax system in the country. But since then, slowly but steadily, including the same finance minister who did that 1997 budget, the system has become more complicated with surcharges, additional levies, special cess that accrues only to the federal government, etc. So the direction of movement has not been in terms of simplification, but in terms of complexity, and that is the big problem here. And the word jobs figures in the budget only once. The word job comes in the budget has a speech, budget speech had 114,000 characters, which is, by the way, 4,000 characters more than last year's budget speech, which was even longer. So in that sense, there is a need for reform of the budget speech length itself. But in all these 114,000 characters, these four characters only have one mention. Okay, so something to think about. This has been covered by Amitendu in his opening remarks. These are the key reforms that are being made. And these are all the broad ratios, by the way, which everybody knows, but I just wanted to provide them here for the sake of context. Yes, I think one can quibble about the fact that revenue deficit is coming down slowly, which means you are borrowing to finance current consumption of the government. But again, in the context of the demonetization, in the context of the actual budget deficit that this government inherited from the previous government, which was not 4.5 or 4.9, but in reality was close to 6% actually, then this progress is not so bad at all in that sense. So what is my final quibble with this budget? It doesn't do harm, which is fine. For the most part, yes, we can have some issues with the tax administration, etc. But does it do good, given that fiscal policy initiatives have a medium-term impact? The election commission might have prohibited the government from doing things for the short term, specifically with respect to those states that go to the polls in this month and next month. But the election commission did not stop the government from doing a lot of these tax reforms or banking recapitalization or giving more incentives for formalization while you were addressing the informality through sticks. I think those are the boxes that, in my opinion, remain unchecked with this budget. So, as I wrote in my column last week, it is a safe and a sound budget for the most part. But does it sort of address the economy's potential GDP and the fact that the actual GDP growth? By the way, we all know that last year there were a lot of discussion on whether the Indian growth estimates are, you know, overstated because of the statistical methodological changes that came about last year, the year before, in 2015. So given those issues, is it growing well at all? Is it growing near the potential? Is the balance of growth appropriate and healthy? What can the fiscal policy do to address them? Those issues have been postponed to another day. So in that sense, it has left me with the overall sense of a bit of a disappointment rather than satisfaction. Thank you very much.